Okay, thanks a lot, guys, for the patience. This is a talk about Clone, and I just want to say it's really a pleasure and a privilege to talk at the Python conference here at Westcon South Africa. And just to kind of get a feeling for what your guys, what everybody's exposure to Clone is, if you know what it is, just see a show of hands who has never heard of Clone, has no idea what it's about. And the rest of you, who has written software for Clone? Okay. And the rest, I guess the others know about it, maybe has used it, but not much. Well, Clone is a content management system. A content management system is any system that modifies, creates, edits, or is used for maintaining digital content. Digital content being documents, spreadsheets, Word docs, or HTML documentation, basically anything that can be digitized. This is what Clone looks like when you see it at first sight, when you just installed it. And Clone being a web-based content management system means also that you can change the web content. So another way of seeing a content management system in a web-based one like Clone is that you can change the way the website looks by using the website. So for example, if you log in, you get the screen edit bar that shows you some tabs. That's if you have the correct permissions. If you go to the edit tab, you can edit the way this front page looks, and you also get some other fields, a title and a summary that shows up in search listings. And set some other tabs here also for metadata or some other fields to fill in. And one definition of an enterprise content management system is a content management system that deals with content related to commercial organizations and handling contacts and records and data for commercial organizations. If you use this definition, then Clone is definitely an enterprise content management system, not just a web-based one. So also when you log into Clone, you can add some default types. Events, files, folders, images, links, news items. A collection is a bit of a special one. A collection is a kind of aggregator. It gets content from all over the site that can be in various different places. It collects it and shows it together on one page, as if it's actually all in the same folder. Clone is open source, so there's no freemium model and enterprise model, Unity edition and enterprise edition or licensing fees or anything like that. It's all open source and anybody can download and use it, and there's no strings or prices attached. The source code is managed by the Clone Foundation, but the Clone Foundation is only a custodian. It's a non-profit organization. They own the copyright and the IP, so if you contribute Clone code to Clone, to core Clone, not to add-on products, you have to sign over copyright to the Clone Foundation. But that's a model that's often used in open source projects to protect it from legal threats and to make sure that it's clear who takes responsibility or who has the copyright. Clone is ranked within the top 2% of open source software projects by Olo.net. It's a really cool website, actually. Went on there yesterday to just look a bit. You can give it like 3 or 4 different content management systems, and it will rank them, not rank them, but compare them with one another. How many core devs does it have? How many commits in the last year? All kinds of nice statistics. It has 6 annual conferences. The next big conference, the international one, is next week in Holland. Usually has about 350 to 450 attendees. There's more than 300 solution providers in 57 countries all over the world. It's about maybe 6 or 7 companies in South Africa that do Clone development. Quite a few of them, like 4 or 5 of them, well, maybe more than 6 or 7, but of the 6 or 7, almost all of them do just Clone development, or maybe a little bit of other Python stuff, but mostly Clone. there's more than 340 core clone developers. So a core developer is someone who has done code changes to the core by core clone code. It's not, doesn't count add-on developers or customizers or so on. And it's available in 40 languages, so there's really good internationalization support. And there's, for example, a clone site in Arabic, also shows the right to left text. There's a clone site in Chinese. And clone then has the best security of any major content management system. You can go into that website, it's the Common Vulnerabilities and Exposures Database. This National Vulnerability Database, which is sponsored by the Department of Homeland Security, National Cyber Security Division, you can go and search actually on that, that URL, shows that compared to these major PHP, very popular PHP content management systems, how many security vulnerabilities it's had in the last 3 years, in the last 3 months. So, I mean, it's not even a contest. If you, if you go and search for Plone in that search, in that database, it gives you specifically this data, how many vulnerabilities. It also gives you information for every single vulnerability, what it was, and how the exploit works. No, it's specific vulnerabilities for the site, not per deployment. It's how many known vulnerabilities does this stack of software have? Doesn't matter if it's deployed a million times or 10 times. You could make the case that something that's deployed many more times gets more scrutiny, but Plone is relatively widely deployed, and because it doesn't use SQL, so it can't have SQL injection attacks, and it doesn't have all the weaknesses that PHP, for example, has. It is, and its architecture is very secure. Plone uses a similar permissions system as Unix. So you have users or groups of users. They get roles, and tied to these roles are permissions. So, for example, I'm at logging as the, you can't see it there in the top, but it shows just a little bit above that I'm admin. I'm logging as admin. I created a user for myself. These are the different roles I can give myself: a reviewer, reader, member, editor, contributor. It's completely extensible. You can create all kinds of any role you want. But these are the default ones. And if I give myself a specific role, I can do different things in the site. And you can also do this per context, per folder. So in a specific folder, you can say this guy is a editor. You can edit content in this folder. Anywhere else, you cannot. So where's Plone being used? Plone is used in just check the time. In education, universities. On Plone.org, you can list sites. If you work on Plone's site, you can go and list it there. It's completely opt-in. So it's not extensive, but there's 342 sites under the category education. On Plone.org, some high-profile universities do Plone deployment. They have often in-house teams in their IT department that set up Plone sites for them and deploy it. Some quite high-profile Plone developers come from in-house IT teams from universities. It's the Open Yale Courses site. It's a Plone site. This is a site from Siavula. It's a really, really great non-profit in South Africa from Mark Warner that makes open source textbooks available to schools. And also, because it's open source and digitized, you can also show it on devices, feature phones or smartphones and so on. This is made by Open Systems. They've made quite a few Plone sites for Siavula. Also in government, so 313 gov sites on Plone.org. Municipalities, the European Union has a lot of Plone deployments. I have a friend who lives in Thailand already for 3 or 4 years. All he does is make Plone sites for the United Nations, political parties, and also federal agencies. This is a site from the Brazilian government. The Brazilian government is really a big user and creator and supporter of open source software. They have a lot of Plone sites deployed in all three branches of government, legislative, judicial, and executive. They have like literally hundreds of Plone sites deployed in the government, and this growth has been organic. It's no single vendor or entity that pushing blame. It's people all over government in different departments that independently looking for a solution and recognizing the blame is a good fit, solve their problems. This side I've worked on myself quite a lot when I was in Germany for 2 years. It's a site for the European Union agency, Occupational Health and Safety Agency. This is a big site. It's 32 gigabytes of binary data, so blocks, photos, images, and videos. It's another 16 gigabytes of text data, so it's 52 gigabytes of data. It has a lot of sub-sites. Sub-sites kind of like a self-contained website within this blown site, with its own domain, sometimes its own skin. Sub-sites for, in a sense, that every European member country can have their own kind of portal inside this site. It's translated into 27 or 28 languages, not just the UI, but also the content. So this site has been a plum site since 2003. Plum is 11 years old ago. But it's not, the code is obviously not 11 years old. It's evolved. This site's gone through two major migrations, from Plum 2.0 all the way now to Plum 4.1. The last major migration was less than a month ago. For a site that's complicated, or not complicated, but complex and large, this one, you really have to prepare a lot to migrate, and it's a big thing. But the actual migration was a Saturday afternoon, and it went off without any problems, migrated, and now it's running on Plum 4.1. And this really is a big difference between, or it's a big advantage, a strong point of Plum. The community takes backwards compatibility very, very seriously. They won't break things arbitrarily, and they also provide sane and well-defined migration paths from one version to another. Some other frameworks, between major versions, they, not frameworks, but web CMSs, between major versions, they completely break compatibility. You have to kind of rewrite your site. This site is for the Albuquerque municipality, city municipality. There's lots of them in America who use Plum sites, and they got together and formed the PlumGov initiative. The PlumGov initiative has spread all over the world in all the places where Plum has been deployed. It's won some awards also. So Plum's also used for non-profit organizations, Oxfam, Free Software Foundation, Greenpeace, Amnesty International. There's some startups that do Plum that only focus on non-profits. This is the TEDx Cordoba site, so it's a video site. There's a suite for Plum called Plumy that installs a whole suite of add-on packages that creates your major Plum site, a video sharing, streaming and sharing site. This is a linguistic research site that has, it tries to document every single human language for linguistic research. It has like more than 90,000 documents. Also then obviously the private sector and commercial enterprise. Often we sign NDAs, so I'm not so sure what I can talk about or what not. It's usually intranets and extranets. I actually do mention some there. This one is really for Starline, so the airline alliance. It's kind of like an extranet for them. It's heavily skinned. I mean, it doesn't look anything like Plum. If you look at it, if you look at the front end source code, you won't know. I would actually like to quickly show. So let's just run through some of the features. Phone really has a lot of features. I cannot mention all of them, so I'm just going to mention some that kind of popped out to me when I had to think about it for this presentation. Phone, one of the best things about Phone is security, as we said before. Not just that it's secure, but that its permission system is very fine-grained, and that you can do a lot with it, and you can create a very fine-grained site where people, it's very well-defined who can access what. And tied into that is the workflow. So all the objects, all the content types and documents and stuff in the site can go through a workflow that's completely customizable. This is just a simple publishing workflow. Something starts off as private, and you can then change it to a draft, change it to pending review, where other user might come in and review it, and he might publish it. But it can also, for every state, different people have different levels of access to this object. Yes. It's based on the workflow state. So you can say that owner is a role, for example, a special role. So in private state, you can say owner has edit and view rights, view permissions, and no other roles any permissions. In pending review, you can say the editor role has the edit permission. Can do that as well. You can say a specific user. You can give users a specific role only in certain contexts. So a user doesn't have to be an editor in the whole Plone site. A user can be an editor only on one object. So Plone also has auditing and history support. So this is just the history page for a document that I edited a few times. It was created, then published, and then I edited it four times. And you can compare two revisions with one another. You can revert to previous revisions, and you can see a diff. So if you change a document, you can see the diff between your change and the previous version, and you can go back. Also, it's working copy support. I actually don't even have a show that. I just remember that now. So you can say this is a working copy. There's the live copy. Don't touch that. I'm just working on a working copy. You can also undo other stuff because the database is transactional. You can you can cut and paste objects into different folders and then undo that again, as long as later transactions don't depend on that having happened. But it's content rules. Content rules are kind of like things where you say, if a CRUD-like operation, copy, rename, update, delete, if an operation like that happens, do X. So, and X can be anything. You can write your own stuff. So often like email someone or change the workflow state. You know, just quickly through the web created one content rule that says if an object is added of a certain type, email me and change the workflow state. But it's really open-ended what you can do with it. And so you create a content rule and then you apply it on a type. Bonus through the web content types. And not through the web content types, you can create content types through the web. And this I now really do want to show you guys. Dexterity. The new typing system is called Dexterity. Okay. Luckily, I actually have two versions of it. This should work. So I was really like thinking I'm not going to have enough time, so I really like did this quickly. So I'm going to pause now and then. This might be quite quick. You go to the phone control panel, to the dictionary content types section, and then you can add a new content type. Content types are these things that I said you can add to the site, right? Like events, news items, documents, blah, blah, blah. So let's say you want to have a site where you sell used cars. So I create a car content type. And I create a container as well. Now I go inside it and I'm going to add the fields that I want. First, behaviors are just concepts where you can apply behaviors on content type, for example, to often it's special fields, like metadata fields or so, or it can be the ID of the object is derived from the type of, just to give you nice URLs, because the ID is going to be URLs. So I'm just turning off the Dublin Core metadata behavior, just so that it's clear to you what, so it doesn't show these fields later, so you don't know like where these fields come from, because they weren't added explicitly. So I add a manufacturer field, I make it a choice being a drop-down. Go to the settings, just give it like two choices, you know, Volkswagen, Toyota, the biggest car manufacturers. The choice field. What else? A description. You know, description will be a text area field where the user can just describe what the car looks like. By default, all the fields are required. That's why they have these red boxes next to them. You can change that. Later, you know, add the year. The year should be, you know, maybe I should call it date, but the year will be a date field. You can have date fields and date time fields, and it's like really a lot. You can also make custom ones, and there's add-ons that provide custom fields. So what's that? Kilometers, you know, should be int. Next one is price. Could also be just this is really, really great for prototyping. You can rapidly prototype for a client. You can quickly create something that they want right in front of their eyes. And I think it really helps a lot to allay their fears of sinking money into a black hole and not just making the photo not required and not seeing anything tangible. And then you can add it. Like all the other ones, you can add it. You can, of course, restrict it. You can say that only in a certain folder you can add parts, but that's not, you know, just for the purpose of this demonstration, it's added in the root site, and there's your form and your content type. And yeah, how good was that? Upload a zip file. the zip file has the static theme. I got it, I downloaded it from the PUN website. And there's a static theme and one special thing, which is a rules file. The rules file is an XML file that gives the rules, like, you know, drop this thing from the theme and go and fetch that thing from the content management system and just put it in where the theme is, whether that I drop, for example. Or replace all the properties on this class, all the properties on the body element from, take all of them away from the theme and get all of the ones from the content management system and put them on there. And don't get all the JavaScript from the content management system and put them in the theme. So that's just the rules file. This is a theme editor that is inside PUN with which you can, you know, write the things through the web. I'm still paused. That's the static HTML. It's just one HTML page in this case, but of course it doesn't have to be. It's just a simple example. It's also, you can see in the left, there's all kinds of images. This is what it looks like, you know, static. That's a static site without any injection of stuff. And then when you apply the theme and you go to the outside of the control panel, the control panel will always be unthemed. There's your skin site. So how quick is that also? For example, let's say you want to integrate, for example, the PLOM site integrates Track and PLOM, or let's say you want to integrate WordPress and PLOM. WordPress has a div, let's say class main, and inside that is basically all your stuff. So you can usually just say, go and give me the div of class main, or div ID something, from the WordPress site and put it inside the static theme, and all the stuff is kind of for you, but you generally have to go and look at the markup and choose the different elements. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah, I mean, I assume that PUN, in its actual, in the HTML that it generates, it's got the section and the control name as well. Is that, yeah, that's how it works?
PUN is the thing that's been fetched. You have a static theme, right? And the stuff is going fetched from PUN or some other system and put inside the static theme. So PUN doesn't, the fact that PUN has the ID main doesn't clash with anything, because that's what's being fetched and put inside the static theme. And if the static theme has a div ID main, then you would say replace the div ID main, and the static theme is static, so it's made in such a way, you know, obviously the dynamic stuff doesn't clash with anything that's dynamic in the static side. If that makes sense. It's really, I'm happy to talk about it, but sometimes you have to wrap your head around a little bit, and it's also a whole topic for itself. Just come talk to me about any of this stuff afterwards. I have to discuss anything. So PUN also has clustering and cache management. With the global interpreter lock, it means that you can run the Python interpreter only in one CPU at a time. But PUN runs on the Zope application server. You can set up a ZO setup where you have a server and a client setup. You can have one Zope application server per core of your multi-core CPU. In that sense, you can make use of your multi-core architecture. You can also split up your storage in the backside. Some people split it up to put the catalog in a separate storage and cache that very aggressively, because you use the catalog a lot. But what I really want to more show you is the, you know, splitting up your Zope instances for all your CPUs, and you can then have a load balancer on top of that to, you know, choose ones that aren't being overused, and then of course your web browser on top of that. And then PUN has automatically rewriting and integrity checks. So the path to a document in PUN is constructed by the path that you go to in PUN. For example, you know, this folder, and then inside that folder, and then inside that document. That's the URL also of the object. So if you cut and paste it to a different folder, the URL changes. This can of course create broken links. So PUN is nice. It remembers the old URL and anywhere else than brain. They just continue going to the object. And if you delete an object, clone will tell you, listen, there's some links on the side that link to this. You know, reconsider. And then clone is double authentication. So you can, this is really great for enterprise customers. They usually have an Active Directory or an LDAP system that already handles their users. So you can delegate your authentication to outside services like LDAP or so on. You can have your user properties stored in SQL. But let's say your roles information is still handled by clone because it's only people to the clone side. And this way, different parts of your authentication of your users you can delegate to other services. That's really killer feature for enterprise. We always use LDAP, or not always, but internet usually is LDAP or Active Directory. Live search, nothing hectic, but it's been there since 2005, so it's nice. And then internationalization. I actually mentioned that earlier, but you not only have translated UI, but you can translate your content. Yeah. Yes. Depending on your role, on your level of access. So an anonymous user can only search for stuff that is available to anonymous users. So. But it does search everything on the site. Yeah. If it depends on the workflow state. The default clone workflow stuff starts out in the private state, so then nobody will see it. If I publish it, yes, anybody can see it. Yeah, internationalization would be great. Like Afrikaans has good support because there's a lot of Afrikaans people doing clone, but it would be great if there was other languages as well, other South African languages. There are some files, like you know, code files, translated files for other languages, but they're not up to date. There's two things to translate. The UI,
yeah.
Right? So, you know, this search site, search only in parent section, you know,
yeah.
Basically that stuff, that's translated into 40 languages and that's not an issue.
Yeah.
But also, obviously, if you create now a car, content, you fill in, now you create a car, you fill in the form and your description is in English and you want that now to be also in another language, and you can translate. So this is screenshot's not so clear. This is a folder. It's the events folder. So I'm translating the events folder into an Afrikaans. I would call it now what's events again here or something. Anyway, and then you have two objects. And if you search the site, there's different ways to determine in what language you're searching the site or viewing the site. But then depending on whether it's English, you see the English objects, or it's Afrikaans, you see the Afrikaans objects. I think South Africa really doesn't have such great support for multilingual languages. And in Europe, they really take it seriously, and their multilingualism is used a lot. So, yeah, that's just the features again. And then, Clone has, we have to really run through this now. Clone is a single great feature that I didn't mention, and that's really, for me, keeps me coming back to Clone. So I would like to ask you guys what you think that is. What is the single greatest feature of Clone, obviously, in my opinion? Anyone? Yeah? I was expecting someone to say that, and I would also say that. But it's actually the community. Clone has an awesome, amazing, passionate, enthusiastic, very smart community of people who write great software and are also a pleasure to hang out with. They have great parties at the conferences, they have sprints, they all have beer and alcohol, and there's all kinds of alcohol puns going around. It's really, if you've ever experienced something like this, or if you haven't experienced a nice open source community where you feel part of and you work with people from all over the world. When I went traveling South America, two companies from Argentina contacted me and said, you know, when you're in Cordoba, come by, we'll go out for steak. It's really like a bond between people that build up when you work in the community and you help people out. And people, of course, help you out. So, no, that wasn't. is not a framework or an application. It's an application. Okay? It's a very, very extensible application, but application, you can install it and use it without writing a single line of code. So it's not the same as Django. Django is a framework. Plone is an application. It is very extensible, however, so you can write code for it, extensions and add-ons. There's more than 1600 add-ons. You can go and download them from the Plone website. And then why I love developing with Plone, it's Python. Object database makes it super easy. You don't have to worry about persistency or screw around with SQL or so on. I know that SQL alchemy makes this a lot easier by now, but yeah. And other reasons as well, time is up, so I kind of get out of here. If you want to learn more, you know, there's case studies and providers on the site. Plone IRC. We have local meetings, and we're great people. We're really friendly, and we don't bite. So please come and join the meetings. We're happy to always talk to people. You can go to Meetup, that URL, and we meet in Cape Town or in Stellenbosch or even Sunset West. So if you want to, if you have any questions or so on, everybody is very always happy and eager to help. And that's it. Yeah. So thanks for attending. Any questions? Yeah, there are some guys. There's a company called iKnow. I-KNO. I see that they made a few Plone sites. I don't know them. I know everybody in the area here roughly. But you might contact them and ask them, you know, hey, what do you. We also have a meeting, a mailing list. So it's Plone SA and Google Groups. So it's Plone Google Groups. You can ask there. There are some guys on the mailing list that are from Caltech. The center of gravity is definitely here. But there are people there. Yeah. Unplugged. Sure. Yeah, so unfortunately, this whole thing with the. Getting the thing to work in front.